Oakley, Dokley, let's get going here. I've got a local folder on my machine called PCC, and inside there is a folder called CIS 121, and that contains the journal and the private folders that you created in your first assignment, in assignment one. As an aside, yes, I know this screen is very difficult to read. It's recorded in 1080 HD, so if you can, blow it up and take a look at it in detail. More likely, it would be useful for you to follow along on your own machine and open up a Windows Explorer window, open up a Firefox window, and I'm using Sublime Text 2 for my text editor. So we'll be using that in our walkthrough today. You can follow along, and that way you can read the text. Now I've gone through and taken the template that was called xxjournal_template.html, and I've made a copy of it called azjournal_a2.html. That's the naming convention I'd like you to use. Put your initials in the first part of the name, and put the assignment at the last part of the name. I have Windows Explorer set up to show me the extension. You can do that in Tools, in Folder Options, View, Show Hidden Files, Do Not Hide Extensions, and you can apply that. That way I can see my file extensions. Also, if I open it up and I look in the Style Sheets folder, there's a style sheet template, xxjournal.css. I've made a copy of that and named it azjournal_a2.css. As we go through and we work with JavaScripts, you'll see that that'll happen. That'll be renamed as well. Professional web designers use a version control system to maintain which versions of files they're using. In this class, you're going to use a new file for every assignment. That way I can go back and look at your old assignments and see how much progress you've made. So every time you create a new assignment file, you'll take the last one, you'll copy it, and you'll rename it for the current assignment. Let's take a look at this file. I'm going to just drag this file and drop it into Firefox. There we go. I'm also going to use in Sublime Text 2, I'm going to open a folder. This allows me to go in and see all of the files inside Sublime Text 2. Takes me a minute to find it. Yes, indeed. I need to go down into Zim PCC. There it is. CS122. View sidebar, show sidebar. The convenient thing about having the folders in the sidebar is it allows me to jump quickly from one folder to another and just bounce back and forth. One of the things that Sublime Text 2 allows me to do is to greatly increase the size of the fonts, and that will help us see the text as we walk through it. So now I'm looking at in a whole screen full of Sublime Text 2. On the left hand side is the folder. On the right hand side over here is a overview of the entire file. And you can see my window sliding down it as I look at the whole thing. That's one of the nice things about Sublime Text 2 is this overview of the file. Knowing where you are in a file is very important. So let's quickly go through this file, and I'll show you some of the things that are important, and we'll point out some of the places that you will need to modify in assignment number 2. So we'll start at the top. You'll notice, first of all, that we use a lot of comments. This level of commenting is unusual, but it's there because I want to explain the template for you. The first thing we see is an XML tag That helps the validator understand how to interpret the rest of the file. The next thing we see is the doctype tag. As you know, as you've read the materials, doctype tags are very important. They not only tell the validator how to interpret the rest of the tags in the file, but it also, both of these tags work together to tell the browser how to render the file. I'm using XHTML 1.0 transitional. Whether or not that's the correct one for your assignment, well, you'll just have to read the assignment to find out. The first tag that we see, the first HTML tag, and notice how Sublime Text 2 is coloring them uniquely so that it makes them easy to see. The first tag we see is the HTML container tag. If I move my pointer over near the line number, you can see this small triangle, and if I click on that, you can see I collapse or I fold all of the code inside that container. Inside the HTML is the rest of the page. The first thing we see is the head container. This contains all of the information the browser needs to display the page. Again, I'm going to fold that and collapse it, and you can see that I also have a body container, a head container, and a body container. No surprises here. Let's take a look at the head container quickly. The first meta tag we use is another one, which just helps us understand, helps the browser understand, and helps the validator understand which character set to use. I know this sounds like gobbledygook if you've never run into any of this before, but if you get an error from the validator saying, I don't know what character set I'm using, it's because you don't have this tag. The next tag is the thing that shows us the title at the top of the browser window. This is an example of a place where you need to replace some of the text in this file with your details. In particular, anytime you see student name, you've got to replace it with your name. Next, we see a link tag. A link tag is the way that we tell the browser where to go get that style sheet. We tell it the relation we're linking to is a style sheet, and it's of type text, CSS, and here's where we want you to go get it. This is a relative link. We'll learn more about that as the class goes along, but what it means is start in the current directory and find the style sheets folder, and then go look for this file. Now, you may have noticed that this file name is incorrect. How do I know? Let's go look back at that folder. In the style sheets folder, I took the xxjournal.css template and I changed it to azjournal A2. Let's make sure we still have an L in that file name. azjournal A2. Now I'm just going to click on this until I've got the text selected, and then I'm going to go back to my editor and paste that text. This way I don't have to remember. I cut the text from my folder and I paste it in the HTML. So that's one of the changes you'll have to make in your template as you complete the assignment. Just for the heck of it, we've also got a style tag in here, which gives us some local style rules. There's the paragraph tag selector and one attribute for color. This is attempting to turn the color of any paragraph text dark gray. We'll see whether it works or not later on. And that's it for the head. None of the stuff in the head is visible on the page except for the title that shows up above the page in the browser window. But all of this stuff is essential for you to tell the browser exactly what you want. So now I'm going in line 13, I'm going to click on the little triangle and I'm going to fold that away and put it away. Now let's look at the body container. I'm going to unfold the body container and let's take a look at it. Now there's a lot of stuff in the body, but you'll notice there's a pretty simple structure. We can learn that structure by looking at the names of these divs. A div tag is a way of naming a box on the page. Everything in HTML is a box of one sort or another. Some of them are implicit, meaning every paragraph has a box around it, and you can manipulate that box using a style sheet. Or you can explicitly define your own boxes using the div tag. And I'm going to name these boxes using the class attribute. So this box is called container. This box is called header. The header box is inside the container box. We can see that two different ways. First, and most importantly, there's an opening div tag that goes all the way to here, and the div is a container, so there must be a closing div tag. Let's fold that and see if we can see the closing tag. Ah, there it is. There's the closing tag, there's the opening tag. And I left myself a note saying, remember, this one is closing the container. I use the syntax for classes that you'll see later in a style sheet. So a div has an open and closing tag, and this new div is inside the outer div because we haven't hit the closing tag yet. We opened a div, then we're opening a new div, and then we're opening an even another div. This one is called validation badge. So we've got a whole bunch of boxes going on. It can get really confusing to keep straight where all the divs are on a page, and we'll show you a really cool way of actually seeing these boxes in just a second. Inside that div, we start to see some real markup. This is a paragraph tag. Here's an image tag. Now, you'll worry more about images later on in the class. We'll learn about why this alt attribute is so important. We'll learn about why this height and this width is so important. But for now, you can see I've got a placeholder, what's called a mockup, sitting on this page so that you can see where I want the image to end up later. This is real common when you're working with clients. They'll show you, oh, I want something in this area, and you put a mock-up there and fill it in later. Notice inside this image tag, I'm using a lot of white space, including a carriage return to separate these attributes. That's one way you can show an image tag. Another way you can show a tag is just to put the whole thing on one line. So compare line 41, where 42, 43, and 44, and 45, where I've spread that tag out across five different lines. Compare that with line 49, where I've done a similar image with all of the attributes on one line. My editor does a nice job of wrapping the lines around. Whether you choose this one and your own line breaks, or this one and the editor's supplying the line breaks view, is all up to you. So we can go through here. Oh, look, there's another example of student name. Probably would be good for you to figure out how to do a search and replace for student name. There's something else. Oh, student at pcc.edu. You're probably going to want to replace that with your own email address. And we get down further. This is an article. Each article has a heading. Each heading contains an H1 tag that's the title of the article and then some additional information. Each article has a heading and it has content. Content is a bunch of paragraphs or other stuff that you're going to show us every week. These divs are nicely nested. I can close up the entire article. I can close up just the heading, or I can close up the content. Here's a second article for another week. It has a bunch of other stuff in it. This is an example of an ordered list. You'll learn about lists in your reading materials. And it has another image. Finally, at the bottom of the page, we've got something called the footer. This is a box that we're just calling the footer, and the kind of stuff that you find in the footer is typically copyright information. This strange little thing here is called a, This little strange thing here is a way of making a copyright symbol. These are called HTML entities. I'm not going to go very deeply into that, but if you're interested, look them up on W3 Schools. This is how you make a trademark symbol or a registered symbol, or in this case, a copyright symbol. And here again is a place where you have to add your name. So that finishes up the big container that shows the entire page. And then the last thing we see on this page is a script tag. In this assignment, you don't have to do anything with the JavaScript, so it's okay if it still points at the JavaScript journal template. We also don't have to do anything with the script that sits on the page. Right now, this doesn't do anything, so you can leave it alone. Finally, here's where we close off the body container, and we close off the HTML container. So that's a lot of code. For those of you who have never seen HTML before, I really encourage you to go back through it and look at it again. Rewind this movie and take a look at it. In the next movie, we're going to use the Firefox web developer tools to actually see how this code is rendered by a browser. But first, I want to make one little bug fix. And you should do this to your file as well. This div is not closed correctly. Oh, I'm sorry. This div is not closed correctly. And you can tell that because if you try and close this one, you get a nice little close, open container, close container. Try to close this guy, and you get the same one. So we need to add a closing div. So now this div has an open tag and a closed tag, and everything is the way it should be. One other thing is we're going to comment out the style sheet. We're going to turn off the style sheet, and we're going to do that by commenting out the link command. So I just put comment delimiters around the link tag. So now this file will not pick up a style sheet at all. So we can see just what the browser will do with just the HTML file by itself. See you in the next video.